Philippines.
And it seems to be hanging out there for the long haul. In terms of sheer size, the Philippines is quite on the losing end against the monster. We've reported earlier that it's a 12,000-ton ship.
Yeah, it's huge.
And it spans over a football field.
Yeah, it's actually, I mean, well over a football field. It's 165 meters long. It's a massive ship. And that's telling in and of itself, because the reason other countries don't have Coast Guard ships that's big is there's no point to it, right? A Coast Guard, if it's out there for maritime safety or basic law enforcement, doesn't need to be that big. China makes them that big, or especially makes this particular one that big, because it has another purpose. It wants to sort of coerce or intimidate other countries. And so you see, you know, when you park it out there, it's such a large vessel. That's what it's there for. It wants to send a message to the Philippines.
Okay, let's talk about the specifics of the monster ship. Aside from its sheer size, how big of a threat is it to the Philippines, considering that it has a helicopter landing pad, it is armed with several weapons? Talk to us about the specifications of this monster ship.
Well, it is a threat. It's not a threat in the same sense as, say, a Navy warship would be a threat. It doesn't have those kinds of advanced weapon systems. But, I mean, it's certainly bigger than anything that the Philippines is going to put out there with a white hull, because there is nothing out there that's that large. So, I mean, I think it's mostly, though, there to send messages, not so much to actually, you know, do things, right? So it's not incredibly maneuverable for something that large. It's not, you know, what it is it something that it's like a big billboard saying that this belongs to China.
Do you expect this standoff to last for about a few weeks, or do you expect it to span, to stretch over a period of months?
I think, if the Philippines has decided that this is where it wants to make its stand, I think it could go on for quite a long time. Now, it won't be the monster the whole time. They'll rotate in other ships. They'll all be smaller because everything is smaller than the monster. But I think that we'll continue to see something out there that says China Coast Guard on the side for a good long time, as long as the Philippines decides that this is where it wants to make its stand. And I've seen no indication that the Philippine Coast Guard has any intention but to do exactly that.
How wise would it be for the Philippines to deploy additional vessels in the area at this point in time?
Well, I mean, so the Philippines doesn't have that many vessels. And of course, it only has two that are as large as Torres Magbanua, you know, so there are only two of the 97 meters so far. Now, of course, it's getting more from Japan, which is great news for the Philippine Coast Guard, but those will take a little while to get into service. So I think, you know, right now, I think having the one ship out there, you know, sends the message the Philippines wants to send, which is this is in the Philippines exclusive economic zone, and we are contesting this move by China.
Beijing seems to be trying to normalize the buildup of its Coast Guard and naval vessels in the West Philippine Sea, as well as the entire South China Sea. Several monitors say that they have 16 ships around the Ayungin Shoal and another 3 ships around the Sabina Shoal. What can the Philippines actually do to effectively deter this kind of normalization from China?
Well, I think what the Philippines is doing is bringing it into the light, right? So the problem from before was that, and the reason we often refer to this as gray zone activity is that people didn't see it, right? It was kind of invisible to your average person, so it happened in the darkness, if you will. And so it became normalized in many places until the cameras turned on. You might recall in 2021, there were cameras turned on at Whitsun Reef, and all of a sudden everybody said, look at all those Chinese ships at Whitsun Reef. And so it wasn't until somebody showed up and took pictures that it became sort of real to most Filipinos and most people around the world. So the Philippines has already done that. Deterring China, you know, everybody, I think, is asking the question, what deters China in 2024? Because the China of 2024 is not easily deterred. You know, all of the things that the Philippines has done so far have not apparently resulted in a deterrence. But, you know, your news report referenced some of these other things going on, like the signing of a reciprocal access agreement with Japan. The Philippines is strengthening its position, and that's probably the wisest thing for the Philippines to do right now.
Before we talk about the reciprocal access agreement, I want to dwell more on the effectiveness of the Philippines transparency strategy.
Sure.
This picture painting China as a Goliath against the Philippines' David seems not to work, because as we can see, China continues to send monster ships, lots of vessels out in the Philippines exclusive economic zone. The Philippines has been hoping to describe China to the world as an irresponsible power, and yet we see ASEAN nations like Malaysia still interested in joining BRICS.
Sure.
Explain to us the dynamics of the situation. Why is that transparency strategy not actually working?
Well, so again, to say not working depends on what you mean by working, right? If one of the things that we did when, you know, at Sea Light, we put out our paper in January about assertive transparency is we emphasized that it's not a strategy, it's a tactic, right? So deciding to turn on the cameras, deciding to illuminate China's activity is almost certainly not by itself going to, you know, defeat China's gray zone activity. It is a powerful tactic in a larger strategy, and I think it's up to the government and here in Manila, you know, together with its U.S. ally and other countries around the region, to decide what should that larger strategy look like. What it does do is it has undoubtedly increased Philippine national resilience to this kind of activity. You've seen it in all of the civil society activity. They just had a big fun run yesterday where people were out there with West Philippine T-shirts on. But even, you know, more significant than that, the increases in the budgets, you know, the hearings in the Senate and the Congress, all of these things go to help, you know, increase that national resilience. It's also certainly increased international support. If we're looking to ASEAN as your metric, that's a hard place to look, right? ASEAN is many things to many people. A security organization, it is not and has never been. So, you know, what we expect out of ASEAN has to be different. But you've seen coming from the G7, from the United States, from Japan, from Australia, from many other places, it's just that ASEAN will always lag behind when it comes to these kinds of things.
And how can the Philippines actually entice its neighbors to support its cause in the West Philippine Sea, considering that so far, based on what we see on the ground, some Southeast Asian economies are more interested with their trade and bilateral relations with Asia's largest economy?
Honestly, every country in the Indo-Pacific has to figure that out. I mean, that's something that everybody, even the United States, is thinking about those things. You know, of course, the U.S. has a huge and ongoing economic relationship with China. So, I mean, they're all trying to weigh that, and the Philippines is no exception. The Philippines has a trade and investment relationship with China. So everybody is trying to figure out where their calibration lies, and that's going to ebb and flow. You know, you mentioned Malaysia. You know, Prime Minister Anwar has a particular view on things. Each you know, in a democratic society, you're always having turnover. Each president, you know, President Duterte had a much different view on things than President Marcos. So that's going to be a constant feature in our democratic systems. Everybody's always making these calculations and going back and forth, which is why it's good for the Philippines to have many friends.
The way I see it, middle powers as well as third world countries are more attracted to China's economic prowess, while first world countries like the U.S., Australia, Japan are more supportive of the Philippines' cause here. How can the Philippines and its allies actually, again, entice more nations, not just first world, not just Western nations, to make a stand against China's incursions, not only in the West Philippine Sea, but in the entire South China Sea?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, what the Philippines has been doing through its transparency campaign does send a message to countries like Vietnam and Malaysia and Indonesia that the Philippines' present is probably going to be your future, right? I mean, if you think that China is going to be satisfied with only its claims in the West Philippine Sea and is not going to eventually enforce its claims in Luconia Shoals off of Malaysia, or in the Indonesia's exclusive economic zone in the North Natuna Sea, or at Vanguard Bank in Vietnam's exclusive economic zone, then those countries are fooling themselves. It's going to happen to everybody eventually. The Philippines kind of gets to go first, unfortunately, because geography, there's so many of these reefs and shoals are so close to the surface in the Philippines EEZ that it makes for more sort of battlegrounds. So that's sort of the Philippines' blessing and curse in terms of its geographic situation.
We're closest to Taiwan as well.
Well, that's true too. And you have a treaty alliance with the United States, which of course affects China's thinking on things.
Right. Do you expect China to actually eventually flex its muscle within BRICS members to further push its narrative, its agenda in the West Philippine Sea?
I'm sure that it will. But actually, China has to look at two things when it talks about when it's expanding its the BRICS membership beyond the original five. Actually, that's going to bring in more voices, and it's actually going to make BRICS harder for one country to move. So even though BRICS may continue to get larger as a grouping, its ability to sort of take a unified stand on anything, I mean, look at ASEAN, right? ASEAN is consensus-based. So ASEAN has a very hard time deciding to do anything that's at all controversial as a group. As BRICS expands, it's naturally going to have more trouble, you know, getting all of the frogs in the wheelbarrow, because that's what happens when you put frogs in a wheelbarrow, they hop out. So, you know, that will be something that happens to BRICS as well.
Right. Great analogy there. Let's move on to the reciprocal access agreement here. The Philippines and Japan are set to sign that deal later on today. What can the Philippines actually expect from this pact, considering that the president said that it's not likely to be very similar to the VFA?
Well, so they are like in kind, they're a little different in degree. So the VFA is a very, very robust agreement with the United States that has had decades to mature. The RAA with Japan is a fairly new creation, you know, and so it basically what it does is it provides some basic legal protections when one country's troops visit another country's country, right? So you want to be able to expect, look, you know, U.S. has had long experience with sometimes the troops get in trouble in another country, and you want to make sure that they have the same, or at least something close to the same legal protections that they would have if they were still in the United States. So this is what these kinds of agreements do, and what it lays the groundwork for is the ability to deploy troops without having to write entire encyclopedias of rules for all of the things that are going to happen while they're there, because the rules are already written. So what you should expect is you should expect more exercising, more training with Japan, which is really important because Japan is actually one of the most important both economic and security partners that the Philippines will have going forward. It's really become so much more important strategically, even in the last several years.
But Ray, how helpful will this pact be, considering that the Philippines first has refused to enforce its mutual defense treaty with the United States? It's refusing to actually ask for actual help from its allies in terms of sending ships, additional vessels in the West Philippine Sea. And at the same time, we saw that China has not been deterred by military drills between the Philippines and the U.S. So how helpful will the RAA actually be?
Well, with respect to the mutual defense treaty, as you know, I've advocated for consultations under Article 3, formal consultations simply as a clarifying measure, right? So that Article 3 essentially says there's a threat to the territorial integrity or national security of one of the parties, in this case the Philippines, they can request consultations under Article 3, and that would be a great chance for the Philippines to spell out its expectations. It would be a great chance for the United States to understand and to be able to clarify what it's able to do. And it would be clarifying, I think, also for China to understand that it's getting into some dangerous territory with some of these aggressions. So I think that that's all very important. Whether the government here in Manila decides to take one of those steps, I have a feeling that one of the things that is in the back of President Marcos's mind is, you know, to some degree, you know, once you shoot a bullet out of a gun, it's out of the gun, and you can't sort of, you know, it's hard to put it back again and shoot it again, right? So I think he's trying to think, okay, is now when I want to sort of invoke this part of the treaty, or do I want to wait and leave that as kind of something that China has to think about in the future? And I expect that's probably part of the calculations.
All right, Ray, before we let you go, we wanted to get your reaction on how China has somehow dubbed you as the darling of Filipino media.
Well, I actually, for now on, I expect, instead of writing maritime security expert, I'd like you to just put darling. I think that would be great.
Ray Powell, darling of the Filipino media.
I've been called worse. I regularly see that I'm a CIA agent, apparently. I've got all kinds of things that are said about me. I can't really worry about all that so much, although I do get a good chuckle out of it.
Do you expect this to become a tactic, a strategy for China to actually denounce or diminish your credibility?
I think I'm convenient to their narrative. They can kind of say, well, here's this behind the scenes American pulling all the strings and
who used
manipulating.
Used to work with CIA allegedly.
Exactly. By the way, if I'm a CIA agent, I'm the worst one ever, because I think in page one of the CIA manual, Don't go on national television and have a big social media account. But I think that it makes a very convenient part of their narrative to say that, that there's an American behind the scenes manipulating the Philippines. I understand it's, if I was in charge of a large propaganda campaign, I'd probably do that too.
Right. Do you expect this kind of narrative coming from China to send a chilling effect amongst analysts who have been saying that the Philippines has had the right stance in the West Philippine Sea over the years?
To some degree, it may sort of give them more room, because as long as they're focused on me, they don't have to worry about them getting focused on everybody else. So maybe I can kind of be the pin cushion that gets all the pins.
All right, a pleasure having you here live in the studio, the darling of the Filipino media, allegedly.
Thanks, Kat.
Maritime security expert there, Ray Powell.